Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the ULOL Campus Series 2017, presented by Collegiate Star League. I'm Joshua Piscatore-Lee here, back with Bill Jump Carter. We had a whole slew of interesting events happen that first game. Discord taking a dump on us, Skype failing us over and over again. But I feel like we've chased out the demons. We're back, okay? We got it in the chat. We feel you guys. We deserved it, TBH. But we're all about Collegiate League of Legends right now. UCR currently up 1-0 over Cal State Fullerton. And right now, Cal State Fullerton, backs against the wall.
Backs against the wall due to the absolutely dominating, but more importantly, and it's a word that I think summarizes the entire UC Riverside performance that last game, is precision. They were so precise in what strategy they wanted to employ and what kind of success they were going to find when they were going to find it. Not only did they have a very early jungle pick that they prioritized to a specific lane, but to add on to that, they had surgical precision on taking down the objectives and making sure that every step of the way there was no opportunity for Fullerton to come back.
I mean, we talked about it a lot in the pregame, especially when these champions were being drafted. Fullerton drafted a very solid, later in the game scaling teamfight composition, and then UCR came in, drafted that very early aggression focus composition, that one item spike type of build, and then everybody in every single lane was doing really well. That mid lane went staunchly in favor of Riverside. Pingmi doing a great job of applying the pressure to Sakaki Yuya over and over again. Sakaki Yuya on that Orianna didn't do so well, but it's a new game. Fresh map, fresh picks and bans. Malzahar, first one to be taken away.
Nothing bit of a surprise there. They banned the Malzahar last game, but what is just as important is going to be that Gangplank ban. Yes, it was Pingmi that finished with the 11 1-4 stat line, but by and large, it was Saucy Cells and his cross-map pressure that he provided throughout the entirety of that game one that warrants this first ban.
You know how scary Gangplank can get when he gets snowballing, but something very interesting that I'm keeping an eye out for, is UC Riverside going to prioritize that Ashe first pick? We know Ashe very strong in the current meta, AD Chaos, very comfortable on those utility support type AD carries. They could draft in a way that allows for them to first pick Ashe, because I feel like otherwise Fullerton, if it's not banned out or first picked, they're just going to take Ashe in the first rotation.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised about that at all. You are seeing very similar bans here this game outside of the Gangplank that you saw from the last Zyra, Katarina, and LeBlanc very rapidly being taken across and taken out. But now becomes the question of, what are we going to use for our last ban? Are they going to continue to target ban the way with the power that was shown in the last game? Or are they going to continue with the OPs? What we're used to seeing in competitive play with the Camille, with the Rengar, not something that we saw really as a priority in game one. However, with the Zac off the table, both of those champions are now here free for a potential first pick for UCR.
Then again, we don't typically see Collegiate play mirror pro play exactly. Kha'Zix is somebody who's very, very powerful in the pro meta, and it's actually going to be the first pick locked in by UC Riverside. I wonder if Waffle plays Camille. I wonder if Axel plays Rengar. Those priority picks, like you said, are still up. Karma, somebody else that has been very, very highly contested when it comes to professional and level play, fits into, you know, any sort of composition, very good in lane. Of course, this is why we don't talk about hovers, because every time this happens in the last 10 seconds, they're just going to switch to something else.
It is. But what I guess surprises me, not necessarily surprises, but I'm intrigued the most by, is Jay Young in game one, first rotation, got his team to pick him up a jungler. Jungler that he's comfortable on, jungler that he obviously succeeded on. Now he's switching from utility to straight carry jungler in that Kha'Zix, which is going to be very important of a switch that UCR is going to have to make. However, alas, something that we've definitely seen when Cal State Fullerton is on the docket, it's going to be that Ezreal picked up for AD Chaos.
All right, this is a comfort pick for AD Chaos. Last season or the season before, he was one of the top-ranked Ezreals on the NA server. Very, very comfortable on this champion. I'm not entirely sure if I agree with it being picked up this early in the rotation, because at the end of the day, like, who's going to take away Ezreal from you? If somebody takes away Ezreal, you just pick up a better AD carry. So many of them are up. Jhin and Ashe still both available. But it seems like Cal State Fullerton, they kind of fell apart early on. Yes, Sakaki Yuya was completely, like, they camped the crap out of him in the early game, dying 4 times in laning phase, I think. So a lot of the game had to do with the fact that there was so much priority put mid. But it looks like Cal State Fullerton want to take a step back, dial back, I guess, the complexity of their gameplay, and just go straight comfort.
You have to find a way to get yourself a reset, whether that be emotional in the team conversations that you have in between the matches, or that be in the champion composition that you see what we're seeing right now. They obviously did decide to go towards the latter, something that Fullerton has done time and time again, but look at what you see from the rebuttal here coming out of UCR. They're not going to have to worry about showing their hand. Bot lane is picked for Cal State Fullerton. UCR is going to do the same thing. Caitlyn and Nami, a very oppressive lane, what actually has the opportunity and more or less the ability to bully out the Ezreal Karma if they're able to navigate the wave correctly.
A lot of kill pressure too, especially if Nami is able to land that Aqua Prison. Aqua Prison into the Cupcake, and Kha'Zix just does a whole lot of damage as soon as the bug is able to jump in. So Ezreal and Karma going to have to do a very good job of making sure their positioning is solid. Because once somebody gets locked down in that combination, they're pretty much dead. Rek'Sai being hovered, this is something that I have heard that Fullerton has been thinking about, considering that Axel is pretty darn comfortable on the champion. Rek'Sai is just always useful in any sort of meta, I feel like. Maokai, another highly contested top laner as of recent. And it looks like Simon Waffle going to take his eyes and put him on the tree.
Yeah, on the tree, what kind of concerns me right now for the Cal State Fullerton side is, yes, they have a lot of very powerful picks, but they're not necessarily powerful picks that synchronize together very well. There's a lot of oppression in the poke that you have from the bot lane, but once you actually get into the team fight phase, you're not looking at a lot of damage, and so they're going to have to find a way to get a heavy damage mid laner, something that's going to really knock the socks off of UCR, because if not, they're not really going to have any ways of killing this UCR squad, especially if they're able to get something as powerful as this Nautilus to really carry that front line.
Yeah, a lot of damage is going to have to come out of this mid lane pick from Fullerton. And considering that the mid lane is where the game kind of fell apart for Cal State Fullerton, I think on one hand, it shows a lot of faith in the team in Sakaki. Everybody has a bad game from now and then. He was camped pretty heavily by Jaehyung. They did a great job of doing that. That Orianna, though, I heard some people in the chat saying they didn't want to see Jordan on Orianna again. Well, he's not going to have that option as UCR takes it away in their final rotation.
I do like the decision to take the Orianna away. While there was the lack of damage in the first four picks of Cal State Fullerton, an Orianna would have really rounded that out, especially considering that she had two ball delivery services in the Rek'Sai as well as the Maokai. So taking that way is really fantastic. And it rounds out the composition of UCR very well. You have a lot of early game pressure in the bot lane as well as the jungle, and then you also have the scalability of the mid and the top lane to help carry you through the mid to late game once those items are completed on the champion. So a very safe pickup here by UCR, but it's going to be, again, that damage coming out of the mid lane here for Cal State Fullerton that's really going to decide one way or another how successful this is going to be.
And I feel like last year we're in a situation where we can just kind of guess who is going to be picked up just based on the remaining champions, but mid is probably one of the most diverse roles, as we see Taliyah actually making an appearance in the Collegiate Star League Yule Campus Series. I think I said that backwards the other way around. Taliyah, we know she can put out a lot of damage. She was nerfed a decent amount, especially after that phase when she was 100% pick ban in the LCS. She had her wave clear hurt a little bit, but they buffed her back. She's a lot more viable now. Do you think this is enough damage to take down the front line and the carries of UCR, though? Because I feel like it's going to be really, really tricky for Fullerton to get that damage.
Yeah, it's really going to be interesting to see if this Taliyah roam is going to be successful. In game one, obviously you're playing against an Orianna, or you're playing as an Orianna. You're going against an Ahri who dominated you early, so you didn't have an opportunity to roam. But the roam power and potential of that Taliyah is going to be extremely helpful with the Rek'Sai as well as a potential teleport coming from a Sanmai Waffle as well. So there's different tools, different options that Cal State Fullerton has this game, but it's going to come down to making sure that Kha'Zix and Jaehyung isn't able to help catapult anyone forward the way that he did in game one.
Yeah, we saw Jaehyung from Riverside completely carry the early game for the Riverside squad and lead them to a pretty decisive victory against Fullerton. Fullerton, though, not completely out of it yet. They have a couple of games left in the series to find out whether or not they can take down the UCR team. A lot of global pressure coming out from this game composition. Let's see how it works out. Ladies and gentlemen, you are watching the ULOL Campus Series 2017 presented by Collegiate Star League. And of course, the stream would not be possible without the help of our sponsors, Band Gaming, Twitch, and Asus. We're getting into our spectator delay, so by the next time we see you on the Rift, it'll be a few minutes from now. And oh my gosh, I was totally spaced out. We have to throw to our sponsor video, right?
Good job. You can do it. I'm so proud of you, Josh.
Oh my gosh, completely spaced. We're going to be back in a few minutes, but until then, check out a quick word from our sponsors.
Only $14.99.
Don't miss the call. Download Band. Communication made easy.
Hey everybody, welcome back to the ULL Campus Series 2017, the second game in the best of three between UC Riverside and Cal State Fullerton. On the red side, it's going to be Cal State Fullerton. Sign My Waffle in the top lane, Axel in the jungle, Sakaki Yuya in the mid lane, AD Chaos at bot, Swang on support. And I only said red side first because I wanted to introduce my team.
Yeah, changing up the conventional method of introductions. Congratulations.
Caster bias, let's go baby.
Taking up the blue side, it is going to be the leaders in the series thus far, up 1-0, University of California at Riverside. It's going to be Saucy Cells in the top lane, Jay Young in the jungle, Ping Me in the mid lane with Akuya Wind and Sora Sky taking up the bot at AD carry and support.
This bot lane is going to be a world of hurt Fullerton. Caitlyn, Nami level 1, in addition to the kill pressure that they have with the Kha'Zix in the jungle.
Yeah.
Oh, it's going to be a bad time for the Fullerton bot lane.
It's definitely going to be something that they're going to have to remain cautious about. Axel, did have a slight conscious effort to try to show some pressure around the map, but didn't have any form of counter pressure. And with someone such as Jae Young on a Kha'Zix, someone as powerful as a Kha'Zix, it is going to mean that he has to be there for the counter ganks. And so if that can happen and he can really try to offset the early game, that could help out this early game slump that you can see from the composition on Fullerton's side.
Fullerton does have a pretty darn straightforward composition to play. It's like Karma presses R, and then everybody else presses R in return. Definitely a lot easier to execute than the previous game. But then again, all comes down to that jungle pressure, talking about how Jae Young was able to apply that pressure to the mid lane early on over and over again. Axel trying to do his best, but seemed like he was a half step behind at all times. Beefy top laner instead of the carry game playing for Saucy. We'll see how he does on the Anchorman.
Going to have to really try to switch things up in the pressure. Again, even though you had teleports, even though you had Saucy Sales doing as well as he did in the top lane, still didn't show any teleport presence. Now without a global ultimate to kind of help him out, you're going to have to try to use that Nautilus CC to really create some pressure across the map, especially when you have as much power that you do in all the other lanes. If you can find a way to get a successful teleport ward and get something off.
It's like the previous game, first lane that Jae visits, it's the mid lane. Sakaki, very, very much so, more prepared this time around. Then again, we saw first blood in the previous game. Sakaki went down first, but he actually did manage to get the return kill. It wasn't until like the return games where we really saw Fullerton kind of start to lose control of the game.
We have another slight technical difficulty. Are you alive?
Oh, I'm here. I was just waiting for you.
He's alive. He's alive. He finished talking. He's alive. Okay.
Gank to the top lane. Gank. It's like nobody quite dying there.
No, we didn't. We're going to curse the world of technology today, as it doesn't look like it is our friend in any sort of the fashion.
We're good. Not going to happen again.
A much slower pace than what we saw in the last game. You are seeing, a slight mirror up to this point of Jae Young and Axel. You do see them on opposite Raptor camps right now, but with the lane being pushed up the way it is on all three sides for Fullerton, it is going to mean that that's a huge opportunity, but more importantly, a decision to be made here by this Rek'Sai.
See Rek'Sai right now, Axel hanging out by the Raptors, just catching up to Jae Young and experience as both junglers gonna hit level 4. So far, not as aggressive as the early game we saw in the previous game. Like you said, just farming across the board. Nobody really with a huge CS lead except the mid lane. A bit of a disparity growing there as Pingmi 10 CS ahead of Sakaki on that Taliyah. We know Taliyah likes items, man. If she can't get a hold of that gold, it's going to be bad news in the mid lane.
Bad news in the mid lane indeed. We saw what Pingmi was able to do on that Ahri when he had that extra gold. Now having someone that has such an AoE presence, definitely going to be something that could ruin Fullerton's day as Jae Young tries to get a nice little damage hindrance there to stop Sami Waffle's back, but it was in the last half second of the recall, so it doesn't look like anything is going to happen. However,
fight in the top lane, it's a 2v2 as Axel shows up. Jae Young going to get pretty far away though, not entirely sure if they want to chase. Looks like Axel is going to back up out of there. But knowing that jungler is topside, going to encourage that mid lane to push in even more. Sakaki, Yuya, and Pingmi in the mid lane going at it. Both mid laners chunked down to a couple hundred HP. Nobody falling just yet, though. 5.5 minutes into the game. Looks like UCR slowly pulling ahead in gold, a few hundred ahead.
A few hundred, a big piece of that is going to be the CS discrepancy that you have in the mid lane. Again, Pingmi doing a fantastic job at keeping Sakaki down. 14 CS, two waves, going to start racking up. And if he's able to hit that spike for that first item a lot faster, that Orianna having that much extra damage as well as that mana regen certainly going to make these level 6s a whole heck of a lot stronger here for the UCR side.
And the UCR team composition is actually really interesting in the fact that, you know, Orianna generally considered a pretty safe laner, but not necessarily that heavy damage dealer until she gets to that, you know, Morello, Void Staff, Death Cap, Power Spike. Caitlyn, very good in lane, but needs a lot more items compared to other ADCs, kind of has that power drop in the middle of the game. Gonna be relying a lot on Kha'Zix for that early mid game damage, I feel like. So Fullerton gonna have windows to work with. What we saw in the last game, if you get ahead by a few thousand gold early on in the game, power troughs are like, they don't even matter.
Not at
Axel,
all.
Though, looking mid.
Especially when you take a look around and see that how they were able to balance that off. The big difficulty for the trough is that, yes, there's a lot of damage coming out of the Caitlyn, but it's not as consistent or as quick as what you might want. That power trough really starts to even itself out when you get the second attack speed item on that Caitlyn. And when you have as much lockdown as you do in those last rotation Nautilus and Orianna picks, it does help to negate that a little bit. So there are tools that UCR has equipped themselves with to help carry them through those difficult stages of the Caitlyn. But at the same time, you still have to position yourself correctly, and you still have to find a way to ensure that you can get that damage off safely with all the damage, with all the backline threats that you have on the Cal State Fullerton squad.
No, Maokai, one of the best champions out there. It's always fun to play a champion where all you have to do is walk up, hit W, and then they're rooted. Maokai is like the best face roll champion out there.
I don't know. Nautilus definitely has his moments of face roll as well, as you can see.
But you have to like land the hook, you know?
I mean, you press the hook, and I think it's wide enough at the point.
Dude, you've duoed with me. I can definitely miss that thing.
Well, I mean, yeah, but we're talking about like capable players and not like wannabe.
Wow, really?
Let's play League of Legends once a month and then get our day in.
People making fun of my elo, making fun of my mic. It's a rough day to be me.
I mean, hey, your team's also down 1-0. I mean, what is
going on? You're really going to rub salt in those wounds? Are you serious?
It's okay. The salt was already there. I just applied a little bit of extra pressure. Don't worry about it.
Thanks, man. Speaking of pressure, sick segue. Axel rotating topside. I mean, rather, Jay Young rotating to Axel's territory. Axel, seeing that his red buff is being taken away
there
by Jay Young. They're going to jump on it, flashing over the wall, hitting W, just doing Maokai things. Why would you troll in a moment like this, guys? Why would you ever do that?
Guys, don't worry about it. If we pause long enough, they're not going to know we're here. As we do have a piece of technical difficulty, but that gives us a really good opportunity to kind of take stock of where we're at and see exactly what's going to happen moving forward.
Yes, let's stare at this fight and see who's going to win this fight. Is there any situation where Jay Young makes it away?
I don't think so. It does appear that we did have a little bit of a difficulty with the AD carry, that there is an AD carry lagging. Not sure which one, however, the play is going to be resumed. And let's see where we're at.
All right, Jay Young getting chunked down, going to use the leap. Oh, gets blasted cone backwards. So Kha'Zix still in the jungle, going to flash over the wall, invisible, running into the arms of his Orianna in the mid lane. Keep me safe, ping me, he says. And Jay Young going to make it out alive.
Now, to the actual advantage of UCR in this, the only summoner spell that they actually wasted was the flash of Jay Young. Now, you also had the summoner spell coming out of Sign My Waffle to actually make that gank a possibility. So trading one for one and still coming away with the red buff, I'd say that's a pretty good victory for UCR.
Not as crazy of a victory as they had in their first game, but a little things add up into big quantities, as we have learned in our League of Legends adventures. So far... You see Riverside, not with a massive lead, but 1.1k is pretty significant at 9 minutes into the game, especially if that lead is allowed to breathe and grow. Axel, however, going to be rotating down bot side, knowing that Kha'Zix was forced to back. Going to get some vision for the Fullerton team. Sign My Waffle also going to take another back. Already took a back to pick up the double Doran's, and Saucy is showing in the CS count, slowly pulling ahead more and more as it looks like they now get priority on this top lane damage, forcing the TP.
I really like that decision to force the teleport. Saucy's teleport comes up within the next couple seconds, so that gives you an opportunity and a window to actually create that much more of an advantage. We talked about the lockup that Nautilus brings to the table. Definitely able to do something as we see now. Uh-oh.
It could get ugly. Sakaki and Axel look like they kind of want to chase, looking to back up. They don't exactly know where Kha'Zix is. Knew that Jay Young was around that top side. Very tempered aggression coming up from both of these teams. In the first game, it seemed like they were just, you know, typical collegiate players. They just wanted to team fight all the time. Hashtag LPL. But it seems like this time they're not willing to bite off more than they could chew. Really looking to see what they need on the map versus, you know, who just presents themselves. Let's just go get a kill. Much more measured play.
Much more measured indeed. However, look at the CS discrepancy that's really starting to formulate in that mid lane. Ping me is up 58, assuming you get both of those CS. That's 40 CS at the 10.5 minute mark. That's a large deficit that Sakaki is going to have to make up at some point or another. And the way that Ping is able to zone themselves out, being able to show some damage as well.
Uh-oh, Sakaki going pretty low. That's one. Talia gonna go into the ground. First blood for UC of Riverside. This Orianna doing way better than Fullerton's Orianna in game one.
Doesn't have to have the flashy plays of the Ahri, but instead still able to pick it up. Double summoner spells, but now we've got a little bit of fighting here in the top lane. It's just
a tank fight, though, so we're just going to watch this for like 20 straight minutes.
Don't worry about it. An anchor and a tree branch hit each other. Who wins?
Waffle having a decent amount of trouble this top lane, though. That CS lead has shrunk to 4, so it's largely negligible at this point, I would say. We're still with that TP advantage that Saucy has. The anchor going to go in again, but the great thing about Maokai is even if you go super duper low, you can just punch somebody and get a bunch of your health back. Axel realizing that his top laner is in a bit of trouble, now looking to rotate topside while the bot lane of Riverside constantly pushing Fullerton in.
Yeah.
But it's still 80 chaos with the CS lead.
It is not too much. 5 CS isn't something to really boast about. However, you did see 80 chaos prioritize getting that really early Manamune. And so trying to stack themselves up and trying to help himself scale as quickly as he can is certainly something that really speaks to the style that he's wanting to play this game. Now, what I want to see and what I'm very curious to have played out is which direction 80 chaos is actually going to go, whether that's going to be the Triforce or the Frozen Gauntlet build, the two options that Ezreal's have to play at this moment, as we are seeing the Noodle fight happen in the top lane. However, the first dragon actually blindly went over to Jaehyung and the UCR squad as he does pick up that Mountain Drake for his team.
I mean, even though Jaehyung isn't applying, you know, getting all those crazy kills and ganks in the early game like he did last game, something about new Kha'Zix that you really have to look out for is the fact that he can start soloing Dragon like level 9, level 8. Simai Waffle constantly eating hooks to the face, gonna burn the Vengeful Maelstrom. So that's not gonna be up for about a minute there. Constantly going back. Mid laner's gonna throw some stuff at each other. Tsukaki Yuya on the definite losing side of that as that CS lead just keeps growing and growing. 128 to 77 at the 12 minute mark.
And the bigger that that lead grows, the less relevant the Tsukaki is going to be once the big team fights actually start happening. You already saw the 1v1 potential that Pingmi has had on two separate champions now, but at the same time, adding in that extra damage once you get into the team fight phase is certainly something that UCR is going to look for.
Axel looks like he was caught out, but managed to make it out with his life. Not giving up any more kills there. 13 and a half minutes into the game, only one kill on the board. That one claimed by UCR, but their gold lead's growing more and more at about 2,500 now. A lot of that gold in the mid lane as Orianna does have that kill, in addition to a massive CS lead over her opponent. Across the other lane, so pretty darn even. Nothing too crazy.
Nothing too crazy at all. As you're starting to get very close to things that are going to get crazy, however. First item completed onto the Orianna, you can see that first item is getting a little bit closer there for Akuyo. It's not being built, as you can see, in the tier 2 items as far as the pieces go, but we can definitely see that it is very close looking at the gold that they have. However, that was a nice little hit there by 80 Chaos, although look at the damage that they have. With Jaehyung lurking in the corner, though, that poke down might provide necessary. However,
oh, jump over the wall, gonna keep him safe. The Kaki nowhere near to roam down to cut off that Kha'Zix, so the bug gonna stay alive. 80 Chaos and S-Huang gonna get the reset on the wave. 80 Chaos did have to burn the True Shot Barrage though in order to clear the wave out. Oh, Tsukaki Yuya maybe in a bit of trouble, gets caught up by the shockwave, but too deep into his own lane for Pingmi to really follow it up.
Yeah, so what you're seeing from Pingmi right now is actually an exceptional effort to force Tsukaki back. If he can find a way to get him back and get that turret damage down, finding a way to take down the middle turret early gives Pingmi the opportunity to roam. You don't have as much of an ease of access of roaming of abilities like you have, like you had on the Ahri in the last game. However, opening up the map with that first mid turret could be a big opportunity for Pingmi to take the advantage that he has currently and find a way to translate around to the other lanes.
He said so far the other lanes, nothing too eventful happening. A bit of a longer laning phase than we saw in the first game. But then again, a lot more people died by 15 minutes in the first game. So I guess anything would really be considered slower in relation to game one. UCR though, still looking for their first win of the season, currently sitting at 0-1. I believe in their first game, they were playing with mostly subs. This pressure constantly being applied to the mid lane though. That tower getting pretty darn low. May fall in this next wave.
And you've also, taking a look at differences between game one and two, are seeing a much less a much less example of presence for both Jae Young and Action as the teleport comes in. But it might be
CCP coming in. Waffle's pretty far away though. Now, lands on a trap on top of that. And in the meantime, Pingmi actually takes down the first tower for Riverside in the mid lane. Big gold boost to them, but it looks like they're now going to turn their attention towards the bot side. Maybe look for a dive, at least look for this tower. Axel looking to go in deep, going to flash forward onto the Nami. Get the rest of the team looking to take down the tower, but the TP comes in, the tidal wave for the counter engage, and now it's a Rek'Sai against three members of Riverside. Swang taking frontline duties, going pretty darn low, but he manages to make it out alive. All eyes on the Ezreal. ADK a solo on mana, just a couple shots here and there, but he's going to have to turn tail and run. Saimai Waffle, the vengeful Maelstrom pops, but it's not enough to take down any members of UCR.
Here comes Pingmi.
Here comes Pingmi. Very strong Orianna with the CS lead. They're going to jump right on him. Sakaki Yuya, however, takes down the mid laner of UCR. 1-1 on the kill count so far as ADK is now walking forward, looking for the re-engage. But in the meantime, this entire time, Jae Young has been solo pushing topside on that Kha'Zix. He could get this tower, possibly.
The bigger they are, the harder they fall. Pingmi getting a little too overzealous coming down in the bot side. And just like that, they're able to pick up the kill. As well as, you're right, this turret. This is going to be two turrets now for UCR. So even though they lost a member, quite disturbingly, really, if you take a look at the way that Pingmi died, but they are able to get that objective. And even though you have low health bars, below 50% on three members here in the bot side for UCR, they still have the wave clear, they still have the ability to defend this bottom turret, and that's going to be a huge win and a huge gold swing to the direction of Riverside.
Fullerton still on this bot lane turret, they just don't want to give it up. Jae Young and Pingmi are on their way back to lane. Fullerton hasn't really had a chance to back yet, these three members at least. AD Chaos still low, Swang very, very low, completely blinking on that health bar. But it looks like Fullerton finally going to give up their dreams of taking that tower. And Riverside going to take a well-deserved break.
A well-deserved break, reap some of the spoils that they were just able to acquire. That first item being completed. Oh, a nice flash, but that might still mean the end of Pingmi.
Axel running after Pingmi. Orianna forced to flash away, no real chase down ability for them. So UCR's mid laner going to make it away with his life. Remember, that mid lane tower and that top lane tower on Fullerton's side both down as the dragon respawns.
Gonna have it be a nice little reset here for Fullerton, giving them the ability to kind of recollect themselves and hope to get a little bit more of a reset. You are seeing the Frozen Gauntlet build, the hand being shown by AD Chaos. I like this ability to help the kite, help keep the other members off, especially with this powerful and, more importantly, farmed up member of UCR in Jae Young and his Kha'Zix. But now, tied 1-1, but the four turrets. Objective control, something that UCR certainly prioritized in game one. Definitely something they're keeping true here in game two.
Fullerton gonna start on the Mountain Drake. The members of Riverside actually looking to turn their attention towards the mid lane while Fullerton doing their best to take down second Mountain Drake of the game. The mid wave gonna get pushed in. Caitlyn has an item and a half, so they take down these towers relatively decently. Fullerton looking for the flank though, looking for the fight. Swang and Sakaki Yuya kind of caught out on the outside. Axel goes in deep for the fight, and here comes the full dive to the bot lane. Sora going very low, first one to fall in the fight. Jae Young in the midst of all the big shockwave landing onto like everybody from Fullerton. Two kills coming in for Pingmi so far, as the rest of Fullerton has to turn tail and run. Riverside's first goal was to take down this tower. Looks like they're going to get it.
They're going to not only get the turret, they're going to get the kills. And again, it's on the back of Pingmi. Pingmi I Ends might be the username, but it should be changed to Pingmi I Carry with the way that he's dominated the lane and is able to translate that almost the full flame horizon here. 210 CS to the 114 to Sakaki. And every step of the way, UCR is just 3, 4, 5 steps ahead.
My goodness, like the first game we saw was just pure aggression coming out from Riverside. The game was over for Fullerton before they even knew what hit them. But this game was so much more surgical. We were kind of commenting on how the action was kind of slow towards the beginning. But all of a sudden, it's like when you imagine a dam breaking and like the floodgates like breaking loose. That pressure was just building up over the first 15, 20 minutes of the game. And then all of a sudden, UCR hits just every side of the map, taking down fights, taking down towers. And we just blinked, and all of a sudden, we're looking at a Riverside with an 8K gold lead at 20 minutes.
And the best part about this gold lead is that this strategy that we're seeing them employ, that blink of an eye, click on and off switch toggle that they've had in the past, I would say, what, 3 minutes? It all started in the champ select. they had the pressure that the Kha'Zix brings innately with the power that he has in the current meta, and they allowed Pingmi to do what he does best in the lane phase. They allowed Saucy to get that frontline ability with the tank items, and then they were able to use that to carry them in the mid game. Once they hit the peak, once they were able to go over the edge in their items, that's when they decided to fight. You had the death cap completed in the mid lane. You had the spirit visage completed onto Saucy Cells in the top lane. They took that opportunity, they ran with it, they proved victorious, and now they've got an unbelievable advantage at 21 minutes in.
Then again, even with that said, I feel like Fullerton still have a bit of a window to work with. We're very concerned about the damage output of Fullerton's team comp, but looking across the board, nobody has really built armor yet. We know Nautilus is pretty unkillable once he gets his items, but considering that he's been prioritizing MR for the Maokai matchup, AD Chaos still has a chance to do a lot of damage to this frontline tank. But as time goes on, as those items get finished, I mean, he's already halfway done with the Sunfire Cape, this clock is ticking down fast.
Clock is definitely
unlike this team fight, which is ticking down like incredibly slow.
The noodles have slowly but surely been reformed. It's now wooden sticks. They hit a little bit harder. They're still not quite as relevant. It's going to take a lot of wooden stick hits to take down a tree, but all the while it still does a little bit more damage, as now we're getting into the rotational prowess that UCR provided and showed us and exemplified in game one, taking down their sixth turret of the game, doing it as a team. They don't need to do the 4-1 split the last time. Let's all travel together, let's all travel as a unit, because if it ain't broke, don't fix it.
6-0 in terms of towers right now. Fullerton has not taken a single tower thus far in this game, and we saw so much of this game blow open when that bot lane fight happened. Fullerton was trying so hard to get that bot lane dive and tower. They invested so much into it, ended up giving a ton away, and never even got the tower to begin with. A lot of times in League of Legends, people make the mistake of trying to force plays, but a lot of times, like in the case of UCR, you just kind of have to wait for your opponent to force a play and take advantage of that.
Taking advantage is exactly what UCR has been able to do. And that's the difficulty that Fullerton faces. It's not that every lane is playing it quite terribly. You can take a look at Waffle. You can take a look at AD Chaos and S-Hong. They didn't play the lanes poorly. One death in the bot lane, one death in the top lane. Not something that you can really scoff at, per se. But it's the fact that they're not able to do anything extra and above and beyond. When you think about the peak of League of Legends play, it all comes down to what you're able to push. What limits are you able to break on your opponent, and how are you able to restrict their movements? That is what UCR's strength has been in both games here consistently. Not only do they pick themselves up a lead, but they make sure to find a way to ensure Fullerton that they cannot come back and they cannot find a counter strategy.
Yeah, right now UCR looking to prioritize vision. Uh-oh! Axel gonna run right into Jae Young, AD Chaos. Gonna try and chase him up. It looks like Fullerton wanna commit to this fight. The Tidal Wave to disengage. Axel, the tank's going over the wall. They're gonna jump onto Sora's guy first. Shockwave on the back line. S-Wong goes down. Sakaki Yuya, now the focus of every member of UCR as Caitlyn finds the final shot to take him down. Orianna popping up in the kill feed, taking down AD Chaos. That is all the damage from Fullerton's team. Down for the count. 4-0 in the Baron fight. Axel, the only one to make it out alive. 45 seconds till Drake is up. The entire map available to UCR.
No worries about going for Baron. They're just going to put in and push strong. They know that they have an advantage, and they're going to capitalize on it. It was a beautiful effort. Again, prioritization and precision coming out of UCR. Pingmi went straight to the back line. So much focus from Fullerton came down on killing Sora's guy on that Nami. Not a priority target at all. It loses four members of a life. It loses an inhibitor turret as well as the inhibitor itself, and leaves the Baron wide open for the taking.
5 seconds till the next dragon is up, so that's available to UCR. 7 towers to their name to Fullerton 0. About 13,000 more gold in their pockets. 7-2 in kills. Hey, but at least Fullerton is tied on dragons.
They are indeed. It's the little things, Josh. Sometimes you have to find the minimalistic value and what little value is actually held.
You know why Fullerton's losing? I have a theory.
It's not because you're not coaching.
I was going to say it's because I'm not coaching. Why do you have to take these things away from me, just like UCR is taking away Fullerton's dreams right now?
Man, sometimes you just have to look back and say, I can't help you anymore. And that's
I may or may not be wearing a Fullerton shirt. And we gotta see... take it off now.
Come on now, we're on stream. Don't be talking about this kind of stuff.
Oh, we can't. Oh, it's not.
No. Okay.
CSL anyway. After dark. Anyway, 7-2 in kills. UCR hilariously ahead. Mid inhibitor is down for Fullerton, so they're gonna have to keep an eye on that mid lane, make sure it's not completely pushed in. UCR still playing it steady though, making sure to get rid of the vision. Like you said, forcing Fullerton to always be playing on their back foot and really dictating where the action happens on the map. Fullerton kind of playing scared.
Yeah, and the ward prioritization that they have as well. You can see the double scrying orbs as well as the double upgraded sweepers. It's going to be a Baron attempt, no contest there by UC or by Cal State Fullerton. There's literally no possible way for them to be able to get anything crazy done. There's no way they can contest. They're so far behind in gold. 273 to 159 CS discrepancy in the mid lane. That is an unbelievable number and something that Fullerton is really going to have to find a way to stall this out if they have any chance of succeeding.
Even if they stall out, don't you think that it's UCR who's just going to win the scaling game to begin with?
I think I agree. Something that we talked about was the lack of backline damage. AD Chaos, while he is going for the damage now with the Blade of the Rune King coming into play, you still don't have anything coming out of Sakaki. Sakaki has the Marilla Nomicon, which isn't as impressive as what it was, say, mid-time last season, trying to go for the Abyssal Scepter now, and they just don't have any way to deal with it. And you can see with the difficulty of their wave clear, as you can see UCR pushing in the top lane.
Yeah, that Orianna has 3.5 items. A lot of CDR to boot. That Shockwave is going to come up so damn quick, especially considering that Pingmi has hit level 16. We're only 27.5 minutes into the game, too. Sitting at over 10 CS a minute, that's something incredibly hard to do for pro players, let alone a mid laner at the collegiate level. This is impressive.
You also have to add in the impact that he's having. 5-1-2, weaving in the kills with that is fantastic, as it does look like the tower's going to go down. I wouldn't be surprised if Saucy Cells tries to pick up some sort of engage on the front of this as well. Here it goes.
Oh, S1 gets caught. This is the go button for UCR, but it looks like Fullerton's still ready for the fight. Big shockwave onto the back line. That's all of their damage gone. A triple kill for Pingmi in the mid lane for UCR. And just like that, a fourth picked up. Quadra kill for Orianna. 12-2 on the kill count. And Fullerton just evaporates off of Summoner's Rift. UCR sweeping them 2-0. In the ULL Campus Series.
When you didn't think that they could become any more efficient than they did in the performance that they had in Game 1, they're able to surprise the masses and pull out an astounding victory here in Game 2. Point by point precision, the same way that they had in Game 1, translated it over. Pingmi, by far and large, the MVP. 11-1-4 in Game 1, 9-1-3 in Game 2, putting the team on the back and saying, let's get on the boat, let's ride down the river, take Fullerton down in the process. They're able to even out now their ULL Campus Series record at 1-1 at the end of Week 2, and they certainly did it in stunning fashion.
Fullerton now falling to 1-1. They were undefeated thus far. 1-0, I guess, technically counts as undefeated. But I totally agree with you in what you said about Pingmi Int. Every single series, we pick a Band Gaming MVP. I think it's really hard to argue for anybody else. Jae Young did a great job in the beginning of the previous game, but the consistency that Pingmi was able to show in that mid lane, definitely a lot of props go to UCR. Fantastic game.
Without a doubt. And like we said, that is going to put UC Riverside at 1-1. That's going to be dropping Cal State Fullerton down to 1-1 as well in the standings. You do still have Advancing Technology sitting at 2-0 at the end, but this is going to mean that the middle of the pack now for the Division West 6 is certainly going to be up for grabs. It's not over yet. Fullerton can still bounce back, but the high that Riverside is on right now, definitely going to be a solid piece of momentum moving forward as we do transition to the rest of the season.
Right on. Congratulations to UC Riverside for taking down Cal State Fullerton 2-0. I know I was very excited to cast this match considering that I came from Fullerton, coached the team last year. Unfortunate to see the boys lose, but at the end of the day, I'm just happy to see high-level collegiate League of Legends. Fortunately, though, for us, that is going to be the end of the ULOL broadcast. Thank you to everybody who tuned in. And, of course, a big shout-out to the entire crew of CSL, everybody involved in ULOL, and, of course, our sponsors, Band Gaming, Twitch, and Asus. For the final time tonight, I'm Joshua Piscator-Lee. Alongside with me was Bill Jump Carter. Thank you so much for tuning in. We will see you guys on the next stream.